officially start a public event, because this was the first was part of the film, and the students who need to speak with me, and so some of you signed up for the office hours after class. I just wanted to we can also talk. We're going to do the presentations, and then we will have you speak, and the students who did memos, particularly on the readings today, we can have a discussion about that. So please feel free to chip in, come in, and engage the conversation. So I want to first make sure that we understand that we are meeting on Ohlone, unceded, colonized, and occupied territory. It's very important to reiterate that and remind ourselves of where we're at, the context we're at. I also want to thank you all for coming and recognize that we are at a very historic moment at San Francisco State. As you know, we are going through the struggle to defend and advance ethnic studies. It's not the same as 1968. We have a college, so it's not like we're starting from zero. We actually have something to build on. But I just want to also salute and support the students who have been doing an amazing job of organizing, of presenting non-negotiable and uncompromising positions in the administration. Those of you who were there today, how many of you were there today? Okay, so you know, right? You know that actually the administration is actually responding even every single time quicker, faster. So don't treat it that they're not responding to the students' demands. Actually, they're not going to respond, because to respond to the student demands means restructuring the whole way they look at the university and corporate money and all of this stuff and so on. But the fact that they keep increasing the figure, like when they started there was zero, then they said 200,000, today they said 250,000. Actually, the provost, three vice presidents came. Mm-hmm. I think it's really important for people to kind of remember that and not to think of it as a defeat, to actually think of it as a victory for the students. We can talk a little bit more about that if you'd like, as we discuss the video of when is the strike and link the past, different past, right? And the present. And so, and today the focus is we are in recognition of Women's History Month. We are, the panel we're organizing is called Decolonizing Feminisms, and the S at the end is really important to remember, it's plural, we're talking about plurals. The grounding gender, sexual, and racial justice, because we want to make sure that everything is linked together. And we have two speakers. We were supposed to have more, actually, but some speakers were unable to make it. Some speakers, because we actually don't have the funds to bring everybody, even though the Center for Race and Gender has been really generous with support and has been supportive of all of the work that we're doing. And they're going up through the similar struggle at UC Berkeley, mm-hmm. to the one we're going through at San Francisco State here in Ethnic Studies, and maybe my colleague Alisa Bierria can refer to that in her discussion. But we're thankful to the support and the sponsorship, and we're also thankful for you, Lisa, for being here. I don't think you sent me your bio, but I'm going to, you know, Alisa is a doctor of philosophy,
no.
or close to being a doctor of philosophy.
Aspirational.
Yeah, and she is the associate director of the Center for Race and Gender at UC Berkeley. Alisa is also a founding member of Insight, Women of Color Against Violence. So this is, it's really, and many, many other ways. So what we're going to do, I'm going to actually present a paper that I wrote about this, and then Alisa is going to make a presentation, then we're gonna open it up for the discussion. So if you have any questions, please write them down. You have pieces of paper and we can have conversation. I'm sorry we're sitting in a theater style rather than a round table, but we need to make sure that we have enough space. Okay, so I'm actually going to stand because I'm worried that if I'm sitting down, you don't hear me. So the title of my paper is called From Ida Bells to Palestine, Decolonizing Feminisms, Grounding Gender, Sexual and Racial Justice. On November 26, 2005, members of the National Women's Studies Association, NWSA, overwhelmingly voted 88.4% in favor of a strong and unambiguous resolution supporting boycott, divestment, and sanctions against Israel. Proposed by Feminists for Justice in for Palestine, a coalition founded at the 2014 NWSA conference in San Juan, Puerto Rico, the resolution drew on principles of the indivisibility of justice, that brought to the fore the philosophy of Martin Luther King Jr., an anti-racist, justice-centered feminism. What made this NWSA vote possible in general, but at this particular historic moment in particular? Is it about conventional feminist wisdom that assumes that feminism in itself is emancipatory for gender and sexual injustices? What conclusions can we draw from this experience on gender and sexual justice, advocacy for justice in and for Palestine, and the academic intellectual enterprise in the age of neoliberal corporate university in general? I believe that several factors contributed to the NWSA BDS vote. First and most immediately, the political context of escalating and intensifying Israeli colonial violence against the Palestinians in Gaza, Jerusalem, the West Bank, and the 48 areas. This has coincided with the 2014 NWSA conference in Puerto Rico. This was right after the summer of Gaza, that people probably remember. The NWSA San Juan meeting also underscored Palestinian-Puerto Rican solidarity. The grounds were already set in Puerto Rico with several rallies and protests against the Israeli war on Gaza and the renewed wave of colonial settler violence against Palestinians. Historically, Puerto Rican independentistas, including freed political prisoners such as Rafael Cancel Miranda, Lolita Lebron, Ida Luz and Alicia Rodriguez, and later on Elias Castro and Yvonne Melendez and other members of the Hartford 16. The Young Lords Party, the Puerto Rican Socialist Party, FALN, El Comité, have long expressed solidarity with the Palestinian anti-colonial struggle. Later on, Los Macheteros, the Committee Against Repression, the U.S. Out of Yekes Committee campaign, and most recently, Boricuas for Palestine, have maintained this solidarity. Well-established artists such as Ricky Martin, Kaya 13, and Danny Rivera have all expressed solidarity with Palestine. If you didn't know, now you do. On the second night of the NWSA conference, a Palestinian-Puerto Rican solidarity standing room only event entitled From Puerto Rico to Palestine, Decolonization, Liberation, and the Indivisibility of Justice was co-sponsored by American Association of Jurists and AMED, Arab and Muslim Ethnicity and Diaspora Studies Program, and El Colegio, which took place at El Colegio headquarters, which is the Puerto Rican Bar Association. In a longer paper, I discuss what happened to El Colegio and relentless campaign against it to undermine it. And El Colegio is more like the National Lawyers Guild in the US than American Bar Association. It's actually much more grassroots. It defends Puerto Rican political prisoners and deals with a lot of grassroots struggle. So that's why the campaign was to undermine it, but it didn't work. The event was co-organized by Vanessa Ramos, the International President of the American Association of Jurists and co-founder in 1978 of the first Palestine Solidarity Committee at the main Rio Piedras campus at the University of Puerto Rico. The event was moderated by Rafael Anglada, longtime Puerto Rican lawyer. He was from the PSP, the Puerto Rican Socialist Party, and he is the president of El Colegio. The event featured Angela Davis, NWSA President Trisha Lynn, former Puerto Rican prisoners of war and leader Rafael Cancel Miranda, who participated by phone, and Ida Luz and Alicia Rodriguez, who have spent a lot of time in prison, and myself. What I call the Palestine moment at the Puerto Rican NWSA meeting was made possible by a number of developments. One is the collective efforts that several of us actually worked together to make the resolution possible. It was not an individual effort or by two or three people. NWSA bylaws, however, stipulated that the resolution had to be submitted 30 days in advance. So we could not transform the portion of the resolution at that time in 2014 to an actual resolution, but what we did is a petition, and within 24 hours we were able to get 800 signatures on it. I mean, with less than 24 hours, it's only the people we reached who signed on it. Most immediately, and during her keynote address, Bell Hooks responded 100% to a question on whether NWSA should join the international movement for BDS. During a plenary on Palestine organized by Chandra Talpade Mohanty, which also included Angela Davis, and it's important to note that these two were part of the indigenous and women of color feminist delegation that visited Palestine in 2011. So you can see how all of these things are coalescing together. There were 2,500 people in the audience at that plenary. And they all stood and clapped when they were asked to signal how they felt about solidarity with Palestine. Trisha Lynn, the president, said the members have spoken. Of course, at the time, Puerto Rican feminists who were there stood at the microphone and carried the Palestinian flag, and we said we're all for Palestine. We also support Palestine. And this was at their land. The conference was in their land. Also, the NWSA Governing Council also voted in favor of BDS. These immediate decisions, of course, paced the resolution, development paced the way for the resolution that we submitted on October 10th under the name of Feminists for Justice in Palestine. But these were immediate steps that made this happen. This was the immediate context. What was the long-term context? I'm arguing that the selection of Puerto Rico as a site for the conference was anything but accidental. It was a culmination of long and protracted struggle within the National Women's Studies Association, led by feminists of color, toward the browning, radicalization, and democratization of the organization. That if it had stayed the way it started before, it would not have happened. It was not possible. But why 2014 and not 2015? Why not earlier? Why not later? Is this an excitement of the Palestine moment? Okay. Of course, there is a broadening international solidarity with Palestine. There are other academic associations that have already voted, like American Studies Association. Actually, the first one was the Association for Asian American Studies. People forget that. Then there was the Native American Indigenous Studies Association, the National Association of Chicano Studies, the Critical Ethnic Studies Association, and so on and so forth. I can give you more information about that. And actually, really important, the United Auto Workers, Local 2865, which represents graduate students at the UC system, who actually consider themselves as workers. So this is the labor union, which has 14,000 members, and the majority of which voted in December 2014 to support BDS. Okay, so this is kind of, actually we had one of the members last semester when we did the event on queer and feminist justice. He spoke at the event last semester. So there is this kind of like, it demystified the whole question about Palestine being controversy, as you all know. Like every time we talk about Palestine, people say it's very controversial, as if other issues are not controversial. Like Palestine is exceptionalized as such. But I think that the qualitative shifts within the organization took place not in some liberal or neoliberal identity politics sort of way, but they were really real struggles that tried to chip away and succeeded in a way at the white supremacy and middle class privilege of the U.S. women's movement in general and U.S. feminist academic scholarship and institutionalization in particular. Okay, so we can discuss all of these things. So this was very similar to what happened at the American Studies Association. Because for a very long time, a lot of us were critical of American Studies because it is American Studies. That is actually about North America, but it equates U.S. with America instead of talking about the whole Americas, the Western Hemisphere. And so there were a lot of issues that were very similar with American Studies. I don't think I'm going to be talking about that. But I want to talk specifically about NWSA, and I want to talk about specifically the feminist movement, the U.S. feminist movement. So this has a lot to do with what we call colonial feminism. And the most recent incarnation emerged in the post 9/11/2001. Even though it's been there all along, it's not something only post 9/11/2001. A lot of people think it's only, but it's not. There's a lot of stuff happened before, and it's not the only moment. It just visibilized and made hyper-visible a lot of stuff that has been going on for a very long time and brought it to quote-unquote the mainstream in a good or a bad way, however you want to think about it. But in the post 9/11/2001, the feminist majority, Ms. Magazine, the National Organization of Women, and other dominant feminist groups basically gave cover to the Bush administration for the invasion of Afghanistan under the guise of saving brown women from brown communities. Some of you already been there, talked about that, and so on. Historically speaking, though, I'm arguing that colonial feminism began as early as the documented history of the dominant narrative of the U.S. women's movement. And any of you who took intro to women's studies or any women's studies classes, you will know what I'm talking about, right? The waves, the beginning of the movement with the suffragists and so on, right? So there is the argument that the whole movement gives credit to the contributions of middle class, hetero, Anglo, English speaking, and liberal suffragists, as Elizabeth Cady Stanton, Susan B. Anthony. But it completely erases the incisive interventions by African-American leaders, Frederick Douglass, who actually supported women's suffrage, and Ida B. Wells, who fought for women's rights with the same rigor that they struggled for racial justice. And when we say racial justice, it's not because black people should be struggling for racial, everybody should be struggling for racial justice, not a special interest issue. And actually, Anthony and Stanton both criticized and almost labeled IW as a traitor to the cause of women, i.e. anti-feminist, because she took on the lynching of young black men with the same rigor that she took on the cause of women's suffrage. So she did not agree only to talk about women's suffrage. She was also talking about lynching. And if you know from the history, this was a very escalating moment of lynching post-quote-unquote emancipation. I'm not undermining how important emancipation is. I'm undermining US history that claims that it actually produced that rather than the various uprising by the slaves and so on against slavery. But it was not only white supremacy that was the hegemonic character of the feminist academy. For our purpose, it was also Zionism in the women's movement. For example, Catherine McKinnon, everybody knows Catherine McKinnon in women's studies, right? She violated the academic and cultural boycott of Israel and accepted honorary degree from the Hebrew University of Jerusalem. She also, as you know, partnered with the late Andrea Dworkin. They were working a lot together. I mean, and some people may have questions about their sexual politics and how they think about, you know, sexual labor and everything is rape and so on. That's another discussion for feminist theory. We can talk about it a little bit, but I think we don't have enough time about that. But Dworkin, who wrote an article in Feminista about Palestinian women suicide bombers and basically was completely racist, orientalist, and undermined Palestinian women, she was long-time Zionist, was never denounced by Catherine McKinnon. So these are two main figures who have, and I can tell you about Gloria Steinem and a whole bunch of other people and so on. They're not the only ones. There were also in the 60s, 70s, and 80s, Betty Friedan and Bella Abzug, and many of the founders of Ms. Magazine, who, for instance, in 1992, they told Nawal Sa'dawi, the Egyptian feminist, and I had interviewed her, and at the Nairobi Women's Conference in 1985, that she should never talk about Palestine because it's a divisive issue. She should just stick to whatever she is talking about, female genital cutting and so on and so on. In the past, they used to be the norm for feminist scholarship. And I can share more, so, but I don't want to, okay. So, but I think also it's really important to also remember that in the 60s and the 70s and throughout the period of the emergence of women's studies and the women's movement and so on, the master narrative does not acknowledge a whole bunch of counter processes that were going on. For instance, Adrienne Rich, who is very well known, before she died, she actually wrote a letter to Arab American Palestinian writer saying that she supports the boycott as a Jewish woman, as a Jewish feminist, as Jewish lesbian feminist, very well known figure. Actually, she boycotted this on the website. People want it, we can share it. Myrna Bain, who was at Hunter College. Dyke Tactics, which is a major group that now one of our colleagues at Berkeley is actually writing their history. Well, the Weather Underground, they were all part of the organizing around the question of the politics of gender, sexual, socioeconomic, and political justice. So they were not only talking about gender justice, they were not essentialists, they were also talking about all of these things. And they were very internationalist, as you saw, like Margaret Rees is speaking on one hand, talking about, and then you know you see what Leila Khaled is talking about. She's saying, I'm Shadi Abu Ghazali, the Shadi Abu Ghazali Brigade. Shadi Abu Ghazali was one Palestinian woman who was part of the women's armed militant women in the 60s, and she died as a result of a bomb blowing up in her face. She was assembling it. And she said the Che Guevara Brigade. So you can think about the internationalism. And some of your papers, and I think, who wrote the paper? The memo about Pat Parker? Yeah, so we can talk about that and what she was talking about, the US. And so it's very relevant to that. But also one of the things that were really important, it was that it was, you know, the president at the time of NWSA was Trisha Lynn. So this was an Asian American immigrant woman feminist who was from Taiwan, who actually was the president. But historically, there was already all these efforts during the presidency of Beverly Gishaftar from Spelman College, who actually was one of the founders of women's studies at Spelman College, the historically black college in Atlanta. And she was the president of, and she actually marched with Martin Luther King. So she was part of the women's delegation to Palestine. This was, I mentioned Barbara Ransby and a whole bunch of other people, Wazia Tawan, and so on. I don't want to talk about all of them because, okay. And there were, okay, I'm going to conclude. I'm not going to talk about American studies, but we can talk about it if you'd like. I'm going to go to my conclusion. So, gender and sexual justice, praxis of the indivisibility of justice. This genealogy of NWSA vote in solidarity with the just struggle of the Palestinian people was reflected in the 2015. Here we saw sharp and incisive critique of US and Canadian settler colonialism. So the conference in Milwaukee was on settler colonialism. The conference in Montreal in November is going to be on coloniality. And they actually have major keynote speakers who are indigenous women. This commitment will be carried, and I mentioned, okay, 2016. It's also not an accident that at the same time that NWSA members voted to support BDS in Palestine, they also voted for two very important resolutions. One is about contingent faculty. Contingent faculty as the lecturers that all of you as students have been fighting for, because they basically have no rights. The lecturers who don't have tenure track positions, who are not appointed, who every semester or every year their contract getting renewed and so on. So at that conference, we voted also in support of contingent faculty rights. So it was for labor rights, anti-corporate neoliberalism and so on, and also for Palestine. So it actually made a lot of sense that coming together at the same time was not coincidental, was actually justice for Palestine, justice for and in Palestine, was part and parcel of development of the NWSA. And as I said, it was really the most recent step in the Browning radicalization, democratization, and internationalization of NWSA and the women's movement. It was an expressive expression of collective struggle, a labor of love, and a refusal to be complicit in perpetuating injustice, and an insistence on and commitment to the indivisibility of justice. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you so much for that powerful review. I'm so glad to hear. I didn't know all of the details of what happened at the NWSA conference. I just knew that they passed the resolution. So I really appreciate your analysis and rundown of everything. It brings a richness. It's more colorful. So, yes, my name is Alisa Bierria. I'm with the Center for Race and Gender at UC Berkeley. And as Rabab said, I'm also a community organizer with Insight and the Free Marissa Now mobilization campaign and some other projects. And I'm really, really happy to be at SFSU. First, I want to say congratulations for your win for ethnic studies, for rescuing it, you know, for now? No? People are looking at me like, I don't think so.
People are in the struggle, they always...
You're in struggle. Yeah, okay, yeah. From the outside, it looked like it was a done deal, and y'all organized and made it not a done deal, okay? And so I see that you're in struggle, and I see that it's not finished, but I'm gonna tell you, over here, it feels your work is giving us a lot of hope, right? It's giving people off this campus a lot of hope. At UC Berkeley, we have our own struggles, certainly in terms of financial, the ways in which the state has been defunding and divesting from public education is starting to hurt UC Berkeley pretty hard. And we have other kinds of struggles, such as sexual harassment cases and that kind of thing. So when I see students mobilizing and saying enough's enough and we're not gonna take it, it helps give people energy to keep struggling on their own campuses in solidarity, right? The other reason why I wanted to congratulate you on your incredible work is because the way that I read your organizing and the way that I read what happened at the NWSA, as described by Rabab, is that it's a kind of epistemic insurgency, right? And so, do y'all know what epistemology is?
No.
Okay. So who does know epistemology? Yes, okay, can you define it?
It is technically the study of what is knowable.
That's right, exactly. The study of what is knowable. the study of knowledge, the study of who gets to be knowers, what gets to count as knowledge, how knowledge unfolds, how it's supposed to, how it works, right? So, so what's happening is when you do this kind of community organizing, and here in SFSU and at NWSA and so many other places, both on and off campuses, it doesn't only make a material impact, it makes an epistemic impact. What you're doing is you're reframing what the argument is. I'm going to come back to that. I want to sort of bounce back. I'm going to bookmark epistemic insurgency and bounce back to Ida Wells, because I was excited that Rabab referenced Ida B. Wells. Okay, who's heard of Ida B. Wells? Yeah, you're, okay, okay, a few more people. So for folks who don't know, Ida B. Wells was this amazing, amazing black woman who was organizing and doing investigative journalism in the turn of the late 19th to early 20th century. She was a major, major key organizer in the intervention and the mass lynchings that was happening in the United States. So thousands and thousands of black men, women, and children were being lynched as they're during the uprising of the Klan and post-Civil War as a way to basically control black people. It's a form of controlling them through terror, right? And she was what was the excuse that the folks gave for lynching black men in particular? Do you know?
Right,
exactly. And so the frame that they gave was that black men were raping white women, and so that justified this mass terror campaign. So she's an investigative journalist, right? And so what she did is that she traveled all around the United States during to these sites of lynching. She interviewed people, gathered all this data, and found that the vast majority of the accusations wasn't even about rape. Now, there's the accusations that were about sexual assault, and then we can talk about whether or not they were accurate, but it was so fascinating that the majority of the cases didn't even bring rape to the foreground. And yet, rape was the major reason, the part of the narrative for why lynching was morally just, right? Okay, so she has this quote that I like, and this is what Ida Wells says. She says, "Our country's national crime is lynching. Our country's national crime is lynching. It is not the creature of the hour. It is not the sudden outburst of uncontrolled fury, and it's not the unspeakable brutality of an insane mob," right? So what is she doing there? She is making an intervention in the way in which we're thinking about the role of lynching in the United States. She's saying that they're not singular acts of violence, not outbursts, not about insane people just randomly acting out. She's saying that it's part of a national agenda, that it's embedded in a foundational structure of racial and sexual violence within the United States, that it helps define what the United States is. Okay? This is a kind of epistemic insurgency. This is what I mean, right? So I was thinking about Ida's interventions in context with thinking about BDS. And the importance of BDS. And I went back and looked at the Black Solidarity Statement with Palestine.
Is that the 1972?
No, the one from last year.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Although you can talk about the 70s.
Yeah.
So recently there were wonderful black organizers, students, activists, scholars who came together and wrote this really nice statement. If you go online, you Google Black Solidarity Palestine, you'll see the statement pretty quickly. And they wrote a pretty comprehensive analysis of why the Israel occupation of Palestine what is part of this ongoing imperialist violence and so on and so forth, and why as black activists, as people who are part of the black radical tradition, they had to stand in solidarity with Palestinians and in solidarity with the BDS project. One of the the quotes that stuck out for me in their statement connects to the way I'm thinking about epistemic violence and epistemic insurgencies. So they say, "We can neither forgive nor forget last summer's violence. We remain outraged at the brutality Israel unleashed on Gaza through its siege by land, sea, and air, and three military offensives in 6 years. We remain sickened by Israel's targeting of homes, schools, UN shelters, mosques, ambulances, and hospitals. We remain heartbroken and repulsed by the number of children Israel killed in an operation it called defensive." It's killing children in an operation that it's calling defensive. "We reject Israel's framing of itself as a victim. Anyone who takes an honest look at the destruction to life and property in Gaza can see Israel committed a one-sided slaughter. With 100,000 people still homeless in Gaza, the massacre's effects continue to devastate Gaza today and will for years to come." So another way of thinking about epistemic violence is a disruption of epistemic violence is a kind of don't get it twisted. Okay, y'all heard of that, right? Mm-hmm. Okay, so it's a don't get it twisted, right? So don't come up in here talking about killing children, thousands of children, is a defensive act. It doesn't make any sense, and you're not gonna sell it to me, okay? So epistemic insurgency, what it does is it untwists these frames of logic, right? And so this statement and also the practice of boycott, divestment, sanctions. I knew it wasn't solidarity. Okay, BDS is not only a material project, the project that supports Palestine by creating these sort of economic sanctions against Israel, making it harder to continue the kind of violence that they do, but it's also an untwisting. It's also a practice of untwisting the notion that occupying Palestine, killing Palestinians, thousands and thousands of Palestinians, is reasonable, obvious, right? And not only reasonable and obvious, but also morally necessary, right? I think that's one of the most important things, right? It's untwisting this idea that killing Palestinians is morally necessary, because I think that's one of the most powerful frames that I see Israel bringing to the table. I also think that the untwisting has to happen around feminism, and I think that Rabab was talking about McKinnon and Bella Abzug and so on and so forth, the ways in which they were promoting Israel in sort of solidarity with women, right? As if women were not being killed by the Israel project. That's another way in which the Israel occupation, the colonization, is sort of structured as a morally necessary project through calling it a feminist intervention, right? Okay. So the untwisting is important because it's a key strategy to deal with these frames. One of the phrases I kept thinking about as I was thinking this through was, it's like an imperial gaslighting. It's like you keep telling me that this is something that is just, and all I see are bodies, right? All I see are bodies. The second thing is that there needs to be more thinking around partnerships in untwisting projects, partnerships across campus borders. And so the insurgency around ethnic studies, I know more about the one at UC Berkeley in 69 and then again in 99. It was very much connected to the community, right? People's families, people's friends, community-based organizations, social justice movements, very much connected to community that existed outside of campus borders. And so the epistemic insurgency was crossing those borders, right? I used to organize full-time, before I joined grad school, which I reconsider every day. So I used to be a full-time community organizer, an organization called Communities Against Rape and Abuse, or CARA, which was in Seattle. And you know, we did community organizing around sexual violence and also state violence, and we did you know, education and worked with people who had experienced violence and so on. But we also understood ourselves as theorists, right? Mm-hmm. As public intellectuals, as people who were doing untwisting all the time, as people who were trying to figure out what kinds of twisted frames were creating conditions of violence for people, and how we could address those, how we could be insurgents, right? And then the third reason why epistemic insurgency is so important is because of agency. And so sometimes when I think about horrific atrocities, like what's happened to Palestine, what is happening to Palestine, it makes me feel like I don't even know where to start. Right? Frankly, even with the struggle to defend ethnic studies on campus, defend public education, like right here, sometimes I'm like, I don't know. I don't know if we're going to win this, right? But you know, you keep organizing anyways because you have to. But I think that when we take the epistemic insurgency seriously, when we understand that part of the project is to change those frames, untwist those frames, that helps me find a sense of agency in the struggle. Like, what is my work in the struggle, right? Certainly being out there, certainly doing direct action, certainly doing community organizing, but also making sure that I'm attending to those twisted frames, okay? So those are the three main points I wanted to bring my response to your wonderful talk. And thank you.
All right. Thank you so much. Okay. Before I call on students to comment on respond, ask questions or make comments and so on, I want to actually the students who wrote memos to speak. So I know. Yes, I'm looking actually at. I have Yesenia. I have Lubna. I think that, you know. Also Delaney and Yesenia. You did this and Helen, all of you. I've read your memos for this week. Matthew did it for like last week. The one about the ANC and the PLO was supposed to be Iqbal Ahmed for last week. But anyway, you know, feel free. Just like say a little bit about that, because this is part of the conversation. So I think they actually bring a lot of discussion to us. So let's do that, and then we can get, okay. So I'm gonna call. I'm gonna go by order first, and then I'll get back to you. Okay. So you say.
Okay. So I read Pat Parker, "The Revolution Is Not Neat or Pretty or Quick," and I was very inspired by it again. It was really short, but it had so much information in it, and just it was packed with just so much power. She goes through like points of like what we need to do or what we need to know in ourselves in order to be revolutionary in a way, or to hold or have a revolution. What is revolution? You know, she kind of goes through that. She says that we need to know like what imperialism is, how it affects us, and how it's playing out in our everyday life in order to be able to combat it. You know, she really makes it clear, like, you need to, like, know what certain things are and how they are unfolding, you know, so you're not confused, kind of, and you're not going after the wrong thing. You need to know what the real goal is, what your real goal is, what you're really trying to fight, what you're really trying to overcome or defeat, and not get distracted by the other little things. She makes, like, a point to say that we need to realize that when we're getting things, I guess like privileges or things that are extra, that there's other people out there that are getting things taken away from them, you know, and in order for a revolution to really happen, we need to give up our comfort and give up our comfort pretty much, because here in the United States specifically, everyone is so comfortable and we all have our computers and our iPhones and backpacks and everything that we really need, you know, and more. I'm like, I have like two old phones, you know, like at the house or whatever, so, what else? Oh, she also makes it a point to say that, you know, it's important to be in solidarity with people and to realize that your struggle is also their struggle. but not to do it because you want to help them. You have to do it because you realize, dang, like, you're affected by this just as much as they are. And you know, you want a revolution for yourself, not for other people, or not to help them. Not that you don't want to help them, you want to help them, but you really want it for yourself, right? That's the way you need to be thinking about it. Yeah, I guess that's...
So, you know, the question of not charity, this is not charity.
Yeah, not charity.
This is actually solidarity and joint struggle to think about it. The U.S. benefits, and there is a question also, is that, is everybody in the U.S. comfortable? I mean, there is this thing about people being more comfortable, but if we think about the 1% versus the 99%, is it really true that in the post deindustrialization of the United States and the neoliberal economics, is actually everybody in the U.S. more comfortable than everyone else around the world? And I think it's a question we need to kind of raise, because people, once they say, it's like, it's really great that she has an international spirit, but, and this is really good because it goes beyond the xenophobia, but I think it's really kind of like important to think about the global south. So maybe this is one of the points that we can have a discussion about that, and think about what does solidarity look like? Where does solidarity come from? How do people come together? On what basis? And then kind of like not being in an oppression Olympics or, you know, something, which I don't think this is what she's saying, but it raises the question. Okay, Lubna. Tell us about your, and say what it is about, you know, where you got it from and so on.
Okay. My piece is about, from Elaine McDougall.
You want to raise your voice?
Yeah,
you
my,
have everybody behind
my piece is about Elaine, from Elaine McDougall's book, Shoot the Woman First, and the title is called Leila Khaled. Do you expect me to speak about fashion, in quotes? And so one thing, so actually watching the film earlier actually really made me kind of upset. For a number of reasons. I actually don't really like this film. I don't really like this film because there is this notion of constantly, especially when it comes to Palestinians and predominantly Palestinian women, to have to apologize for their actions or to have to apologize on behalf of the movement. And you kind of see it more so now where the high rise of Islamophobia, that there's a lot of people, and especially like house Muslims and house Arabs, that feel like that they have to apologize for the actions of individuals because all of a sudden they become representative to the entire Muslim ummah and nation, and same thing with Palestinians. So there's a point of that really doesn't come into the, that we don't see in this film. But one thing that I really liked about this article was just about the transition of Leila Khaled's life. And I felt like that the hijacking was kind of just a snippet of who she was in her life and who she continues to be today, and how her politics have really shifted and changed in many different ways. And I think one thing that's kind of interesting about her is that not only was she a young, beautiful woman, but I think she also became kind of this, like, quote-unquote, like, symbol of, like sexual violence in a way, where it was like, oh, she's so hot, can she be violent? Like, you know, and then kind of raises the question, like, okay, so then where do women stand in the revolutionary process for homeland and also the right of return? I think that there's just a lot of pressing things about this article, but one thing that I really found the most heroic was her stance on home and homeland. Land and homeland is not separate from the concept of revolution as much as it is that people try to take as, like, revolutionaries are so different and they're so entrenched in these, like, theories and whatever else, when really it's kind of not. It's actually very simple. It's like home, you know, like home. Revolutionaries want to be home, and it's tied to land. And the part where you had actually shown where she was, but she was like, I don't even care, like, about my house back home. I just want to sit under a tree for 3 days, you know? Like, that kind of connotation is really important, because that's also the type of history that is never really told from our narrative. And if it is told from the narrative of women, it's being seen as we're too sensitive, or, like, we don't, you know, we're not willing enough to be fighters, right? But that's also a fight in and of itself. So I thought that this article was a great article in regards to that.
Helen, yeah. Speak about your article. Yeah.
The article I read is The Road from Anti-Pink Washing.
And you're going to raise your voice because you're speaking to everybody.
The Road from Anti-Pink Washing Activism to Decolonization by Honey Mike
from Alcos.
And this article, the author was commenting on the anti-pink washing movement and how they thought it could be improved to be stronger and complex, larger transnational solidarity movement. What the anti-pink washing, I didn't really know about this before I read the article personally. So for those who don't know, the anti-pink washing movement is there's this binary that's created that is Israel is a haven for the LGBTQ community and Palestine is not a haven. So there's this binary that's created, and the anti-pink washing movement is aiming to break down that conception. And what the author was talking about is the anti-pink washing movement is looking at the issue from a Western frame, a westernized LGBTQ movement frame that isn't necessarily the best way to be looking at the issue. So I think what I said the main point is the author sees that the anti-pink washing movement needs to recenter the dismantling of Zionism and the Palestinian liberation struggle instead of the LGBTQ issue being the center of the issue, recentering decolonization, is that being the main issue, and then the breaking down the other issue will come with that.
Thank you. Next, oh, Flavia is not here. Lumna, you spoke Berlin. Where is Berlin?
I'm right here.
Yeah.
I did my piece on mothers of martyrs and suicide bombers, the gender of ethical discourse in the second Palestinian Antifada. It's coming from the Arab Studies Journal, the Center for Contemporary Arab Studies. It's written by an anthropologist. Her name is Lori A. Allen. And in her article, she unpacks the discourse of surrounding the discourse of moral judgments surrounding Palestinian women within their role of the second Intifada as well as the first, as how they confront powerful foes. Sorry, I'm a little sick. Powerful foes of the British Empire and Israel, as well as the United States. She sees the shift in depiction and representation to a mixture of resistance and victimhood.
You raise your voice, please.
Okay. Whereas in the first Antifada, we see a David and Goliath scenario, where it's Palestinians against this giant hegemonic power. And these mothers are seen as the most essential voice to convey the loss, the injustice brought upon the occupation. But as we see in the second Antifada, these mothers are faced with deep moral scrutiny, ending up in societal pressures, societal accusations for neglectful parenting, such as if these women were proud that, not that they were not proud, but they raised these men and women to become suicide bombers or martyrs, and disregarding their sadness as a result for their fight in freedom, for freedom. And these mothers feel that she realizes in her ethnography that these mothers feel the burden of explaining the impossible contradictions that occupation has imposed on their lives.
The end of my summary. Yes. Thank you. Matt, do you want to speak, even though
it was last week? Yes, I accidentally posted that on March 5th, but yeah. I wrote about Catherine Viner's article, Beauty and the Bullets, What Became of Leila Khaled, the one we just saw spoken of. That subject has been pretty well covered so far, so I'm just going to mention one particular thing which I noticed as she was interviewed. She was looking back on the struggle and the place of her place as a woman in the struggle at the end of the 60s, early 70s, and she kind of is remorseful that she misunderstood her role as a woman in the unity of the struggle. She felt that she unfairly, inappropriately suppressed her femininity, suppressed her role as a woman in a struggle for liberation, to the liberation of Palestine. She placed the liberation of women in a kind of like a hierarchy in which she sensed that she undermined her own sense of integrity as a woman for this other struggle, which she felt demanded supremacy. The Catherine Viner mentioned a female IRA revolutionary who spoke at the time, said, "How can we talk about a female liberation if we are not free as a people?" And so Leila Khaled looked back on this and said, "No, this is all a singular struggle for freedom, a national struggle, an ethnic struggle, a gender struggle, a sexual struggle." And she regretted that she subordinated her role as a woman to this larger cause at the time. And she said she wouldn't have done anything differently, but she asked rhetorically, "Why couldn't I be a woman too, a mother, a wife, and engage in the struggle at the same time?" So I thought that was a moment of clarity and evolution in her outlook on her place in the larger struggle.
Julissa, Combahee River Collective.
Mine was on the Combahee River Collective. It's a collective that was named after Harriet Tubman's 1863 guerrilla action that led to the freeing of more than 750 enslaved Africans. So they're a group of black feminists from Boston, Massachusetts. They began meeting in 1974. As black women, they understood the various oppressions they faced, racial, class, heterosexual, sexual oppression. As a collective, they saw their task in the development of an integrated analysis and practice based upon the fact that the major systems of oppressions are interlocking. In 1977, the collective authored the release of a black feminist statement, which included discussions on the following topics: the genesis of contemporary black feminism, what we believe, the problems of organizing black feminists, and black feminist issues in practice. So throughout the course of the reading, the statement rather, they highlight the origins of the current day struggle for black women's liberation. They spoke to the isolating conditions they experienced within the liberation movements of the 60s and 70s, which ultimately pushed them to create the Black Feminist Collective. And they state that a combined anti-racist, anti-sexist position drew them together initially. And as we developed politically, we addressed ourselves as the heterosexism and economic oppression under capitalism. Should I go on?
It's your class.
Okay. it was, for me, I just found it a little difficult to summarize everything, because I felt like there was some really great quotes I wanted to pull from it. So I'll just read this one that I added in there. It says, as black feminists, we are made constantly and painfully aware of how little effort white women have made to understand and combat racism, which requires, among other things, that they have a more than superficial comprehension of race, color, and black history and culture. Eliminating racism in the white women's movement is, by definition, work for white women to do, but we will continue to speak to and demand accountability on this issue.
Thank you. Okay, I see some people like making faces and so on, so C, do you wanna say something? No? You sure? I'm not putting you on the spot, Bella? I'm just calling on people in the class if you want to like contribute and say something. Let me see. Did you want to say something? I'll come back to you, Tara. Yeah. No?
Yeah.
Tara. We'll come back to you. Think about it. Come back. Tara.
Excuse me. I'm actually glad you just read that, because I want to address like the whole class. I feel like the feminist movement is just so extremely racist that it has alienated women of color. And how do we fix that? How do we go forward? You know, I'm here, and I got offered by the National Organization of Women to start a Bay Area Young Task Force. And they basically told me that they wouldn't wait for me to try to find women of color to lead the group. So instead, they went along with a group of white men and women, men, anyway. And then also in the AAUW, they're doing
say what the AAUW is.
American Association of University Women, which to me is just like oppressive within itself, because people that go to universities are privileged. So if you're doing stuff for university women, you're leaving out, you know, a huge part of women that need to be uplifted. Anyways, so as she was saying in her article, she said,
who's she, Julissa?
Julissa.
Yeah.
She said, taking racism out of the feminist movement is a white woman's job. So I personally want to know, as a white woman, how do I be involved? You know?
Okay. So, thank you.
I was curious about the article that Matt wrote, because it related to the video that we watched today about Layla Khaled. And I was curious to hear, toward Matt, so you're saying that, because I didn't read it, but I want to know, that she was about her movement and, you know, being a freedom fighter for Palestine, but she had regrets about not embracing her femininity?
Address your question to us instead of to...
Basically the question is, did she have any regrets forward, not embracing her femininity or not using the platform that she had already had to address the problem within feminism and decolonizing feminism, Palestine and Israel?
Thank you. Any other questions, comments? Because you can actually pose some questions, and we'll take several rounds. But I just wanted the students who have done the edits on the videos to be able to present them, and you've done that. And now the students who did the memos to speak about that. So we will have more discussion. But I know Berlin, do you have a question?
On regards to the speaker, I was questioning. I wanted a question or get a definition of imperial gaslighting.
Sure, I can do that. Because I just kind of randomly threw that out there.
Any other questions for the first round or comments?
I have another one in regards to Tara's, right? What do you mean, a white woman doing what?
decolonizing feminism?
Okay, I'm ask here. Okay, because you guys can have discussion amongst each other, but we actually have a guest speaker and we have students who are from outside of the classroom, people here, so we can have a general discussion with each other and then we can come back and do a round about clarification for student members. So you can also comment on each other's in the journals and online and so on. Not to shut the conversation here, but yeah. Okay. So any other? Yes? I'm standing. Yes, Nianda.
So I just had a brief questioning about untwisting of the morale in epistemic insurgency. Because, like, how exactly is there a method to go about doing that? Because is questioning or attempting to untwist the entire epistemology of Western society, is that in and of itself like the beginning of the unraveling of the morale that's supposed to uphold the oppression within? Like, within colonizing itself? I'm just wondering if that's the primary method to address morale, like the immorality of murder and oppression and everything. Like, how do we bring that to light when the killings and murder and oppression is kind of inevitably immoral, but it's still being committed?
Okay, I have a few people here who haven't spoken, so I know they're trying to kind of like, okay, I'm not calling on you. Anybody else? See, did you want to say something? No? Okay. Yes, Lisa, right? Lisa, yeah.
Lisa.
Yeah.
Lisa.
From Skins?
No.
Okay, I'm sorry. Mecha. Okay.
But I basically question, because epistemic insurgency just like rang a bell. Like, is there a difference with the way that epistemic insurgency is gone about than what decolonization is? Because that's all I kept thinking about is decolonization. But what would be the difference there between the two different?
I also have some students on this side. Jason, Steve, so if you have any questions, the floor is yours. Yes, can you identify yourself? You're not in my class yet, but you're visiting, yeah. Thank you.
So my name is AMED Abakir, and I wanted to ask a question regarding the same idea of the epistemic insurgency. I feel like it's kind of a comment. I feel like there are ways. I want to kind of answer her question without answering it.
You mean Bella or
no,
Berlin?
The sister over here.
Oh,
Lisa.
Lisa.
Yeah.
Isa. I'm sorry. Isa. I don't see very well.
But when she asked or made that statement, I kept thinking about decolonization versus liberation. Mm-hmm. And liberation being a process through which those who are in the know can fight for the known, or what should be, what knowledge should be disseminated, and how those mediums are used in order to disseminate that information. And that being starting from the known, the self, the space of the self, and I guess, calling awareness to the space within that is that known realm to kind of call on or conjure up the strength needed to empower others to be those agents of change. And as far as the untwisting of the minds are concerned, I wanted to kind of ask this question without kind of asking it. But what would you say to, or what should those steps be in order to untwist the minds from the space within, without, and I guess, should there be certain guidelines or I don't want to say restrictions, but restrictions in a very loose sense, but restrictions in who can or should engage in that space of knowledge or knowing of certain information.
Anybody else? Yes, before I call on you the second time, let me just see if somebody else wants to ask. Yes, Justine.
In your article, you stated
and raise your voice.
In your article, you stated that you went to jail. I wanted to know why.
Are you talking?
I said.
In your article.
No, I think it sounded like it. As you were reading off folks' names to jail because of their activism, and then you added your name. It sounded like it, but
No, I didn't. No. I mentioned the Puerto Ricans, and I mentioned the people who spoke at the event. Okay. Any other people? Any questions, comments?
Can I have some water?
Okay, so why don't we take a whole, comments, response? Oh, Tara, go ahead. Yeah, ask.
I don't know if you've seen the Hunger Games. The Hunting Grounds.
I know that film, but I haven't seen it yet.
Yeah.
Okay, The Hunting Grounds is basically a movie about sexual assault on campus, and it has a huge presence of UC Berkeley. So since that movie came out, have you seen any progress in the university taking action against sexual assault on campus?
Okay, all right, so what we're gonna do, we're going to respond to some, yes, Amy.
I have one more quick question.
It's okay, you can
okay, all right, the epistemic insurgencies, I just feel like, what's the difference rather than saying, like, I'm just telling the truth, or like, this is what really happened, or like, you know, like, why does it have to be so difficult? Or rather than like untwisting the lies, it's just like, I'm saying the truth, like, this is what really happened.
Okay. Jason, do you have a question? What?
About the memos that I signed up from last week.
This is not after the class.
Oh, I see. So
yeah, not in the class. After the class. You sign up for my office hours anyway. So I'll talk to you after class. Yeah.
I need to. I can't. That's all I
got. Yeah, go ahead. No, say what. I'm keeping track.
Okay.
So whatever you do, I'm going to ask you.
Okay.
So go ahead. Yeah.
Excellent questions, everybody. I'm trying to figure out where to start. I think what I might do is just go backwards. And some of these are connected, so we'll just see how it goes. So why not just telling the truth, right? Why not just telling the truth? The reason is that it becomes more complicated is because of the role of power in knowledge. So if I say red and, I don't know, who do I want to pick? Barack Obama says green, right? So I say, the bottle is red, and he says, the bottle is green. He's gonna have more legitimacy, right? And so he's given more power, certainly as the president of the United States, but also as a man and other things too. So if we disagree, or if we're saying different kinds of statements, regardless of what color the bottle is, his proposition, his statement, is just going to have more credibility, right? And so the project becomes, how do you think about knowledge, processes of knowledge, who gets to be knowers, who counts as knowers, what counts as knowledge, what counts as known, through a context of power. And power meaning state power, gendered power, racialized power, and so on and so forth, right? So when we talk about, I'm trying to think of a really good example. Let's double back to gaslighting. So gaslighting, who knows what gaslighting is? Nobody know? Okay. Huh?
I said I want to say I do, but...
You want to say you do, but...
Yeah, I'm not entirely sure. I was going to say, like, being the one to, I guess, start the conversation or start, you know...
No. It's like a chain of events, Is it like a chain of events, kind of?
Mm-hmm.
No? All right, I have no clue.
Okay, so it's based on an old film. I'm trying to remember if that film is called Gaslight. It might be. We can look that up later. But it's about this woman who is basically in an abusive relationship. So her husband is trying to manipulate her, okay? And so what he does is, while she's in the room, he turns the lights on and off. And then he comes, and she doesn't know why that's happening. She's like, what's going on? And he comes in, and he basically tries to convince her that she's seeing things, right? That she's going crazy. Which creates conditions for her to, like, lose confidence in herself, and so then which puts her in more danger, and it prevents her from escaping a very violent situation. So it's an epistemic project, right? It's this project of her not being able to recognize herself as a knower, right? Because of the kind of gender power that is driving their relationship. Okay. So that's what gaslighting means. Gaslighting basically is crazy making, right? Gaslighting is you telling me that the sky ain't blue and I'm looking at it and, you know, right? And you have, like, all the libraries say that the sky isn't blue, and all of the, you know, all of the police say the sky isn't blue, and, you know, when you have all of these sort of institutions behind the claim, it becomes harder and harder to be like, no, I'm telling you. You see what I'm saying? So when Israel says that it's a defensive strategy, we do need to just tell the truth and be like, y'all are crazy, right? So that's cool. But the thing is that when you have a whole media system, a whole, you know, Western military power system that says again and again and again, Israel has the right to defend itself, and that's why it was okay to kill thousands of children. Then pushing back against it is not just truth telling, it's a political project. Right? Because it's a project about power. It's a project about power. I want to go back to Issa's question about the difference between epistemic insurgency and decolonization. So insurgency means, it's kind of like resistance that's a little bit disorganized, a little bit like, we'll know what's going to happen. We just know that we need to resist here. There are different forms of resistance. Some of it is really organized. Some of it is long-term. Some of it is short-term. And I think that insurgency is usually imagined as sort of a short-term project, a short-term intervention. I think that BDS, you can certainly imagine it as part of the decolonization project, right? But I also think that, you know, if you think about BDS in these smaller events, when you do direct action and, you know...
Culture jamming.
Culture jamming, yeah. Exactly. You can do it, right, exactly. So you do a direct action that says, I don't know, I can't think of someone, like a corporation off my head who, off the top of my head, can you?
Well, I know that...
The only one I can think of is Victoria's Secret. That's
yeah,
the first
and,
thing
and
in my mind.
And what Quid does all the time, because they always do good, they go quiz and their money is really terrorism.
Mm-hmm.
They go, they always go and they disrupt.
That's right.
What's going on, or you know, like, I was just thinking about something. Oh, the culture jamming. Nobody knows what happens, but somehow in the Bay Area, sometimes ads appear, like the Muni ads of Pam Geller or something. Mm-hmm. Then you wake up in the next morning and the whole ads change. We don't know by whom, but we do know that some group of cultural jammers are doing something.
There's an epistemic insurgency going on.
There is like, it's every, and then people walk around and they say, what happened to the racist ads? What happened to the Islamophobic ads? What happened to the Orientalist ads? Something happened overnight. And of course, they go again, the authorities, because somebody bought these ads, so they change them again, and they put like the stuff that's paid for, the ad campaign that's paid for by Pam Geller and company, but it changes. So this is kind of, I would say, I think this is part
of
it. Because it's
that's
not organized,
right.
it's instantaneous, nobody knows who it is, it's kind of like a bunch of people who do it.
Right.
And they tend to be also anarchists, kind of like ideologically speaking.
Right, and it's very disruptive.
Yeah.
It's very, so it's not business as usual.
Yeah.
Because the problem with power and knowledge is that it's hard to push back on it because it becomes part of just the broader background of reality, right? So another example of insurgency is what happened in Chicago. So Chicago organizers have been doing a lot of work to get out their state's attorney, Anita Alvarez.
Mm-hmm.
They were successful in that she was voted out yesterday, so good job, Chicago.
Yeah. And they kicked out Trump.
And they kicked out Trump.
That's right, that was hot. Okay, so, but what the strategies that they did, like they did community organizing strategies that we know, like door knocking and registering people to vote, making sure, get out the vote, that kind of thing. And that was important. They also did some hashtags. They were like, buy Anita, hashtag buy Anita, which was funny. And then they did this really fascinating thing. I hope I'm not misremembering, but my understanding is that they the day before the vote, this group called Asada's Daughters unfolded 16 banners that basically criticized Anita Alvarez, right? And 16, because those were the number of shots that killed Laquan McDonald, is that correct? Okay, so now you have, this is what I mean. This is actually an excellent example. So you have Laquan McDonald who's killed, and he's just one of many black people, specifically black young people in Chicago who are killed with impunity, right?
Mm-hmm.
Anita Alvarez protects those police officers, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so with impunity means without punishment. There's no consequence.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so there's no consequence because Alvarez makes sure there's no consequence. When there's no consequence, it makes it seem as if killing black young people is a regular thing to do. And it's just not something to be outraged about because it becomes just
business as usual.
Mm-hmm. It becomes part of background, right? And so what you have to do then is be like taking it out of the background and using some kind of insurgent methods. And so putting the banners down is definitely an amazing method that they use. Another method, and I think I'm answering somebody's question who was asking about the untwisting methods. It was Ida B. Wells. And so what does Ida do? She goes and she goes to all these sites. She's relentless. She's relentless. She goes to all these sites. She interviews hundreds of people to try to figure out what happened at each and every. Thousands of people were lynched. So her research project, her grassroots research project, took a lot of time, a lot of patience, and she was doing it in the context in which, as Rabab put it, you know, she was getting disrespected by white feminists of the time, and she was getting disrespected by the NAACP.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, she was doing this work to try, this epistemic insurgent work, to try to make the case, right, to show people that the lynching didn't have anything to do with rape, but it had everything to do with the national project of killing black people, right? So that's what I mean by epistemic insurgency. Do we have a hand?
I want to say some more thing about what's happening at San Francisco State.
Oh, okay.
Because, hold on a minute, hold your horses. The way in which the administration is presenting what's happening at Ethnic Studies, and the way that we are reframing the discussion and discussing it on our own terms,
that's right,
would be, and this is what Alisa spoke at the beginning. She cited that as a epistemic insurgency. Because the administration keeps saying it's a deficit. And we keep saying it's not a deficit. The state defunded public education. The university defunded ethnic studies. We need to reverse that trend.
Right.
the administration keeps saying this budget, it's deficit, and you guys need to balance your checks, right? And then they organize a bunch of deans, okay, to come, three, five of them, whose faculty already supported ethnic studies, and they, so we are actually standing by the administration. And it's really the College of Ethnic Studies not being responsible. When it's just the college that does the most with the least, and it offers all the GE courses. Of course, they don't want the GE courses to be offered because nobody, why should anybody learn about race or, you know, inequalities or any injustices in the US and so on. So we, what we are trying to do is actually, it is exactly what the students are doing. And the, one of the things that actually I think is very, very impressive that the students did at the beginning is that they said, our demands are non-negotiable and they're together. They're comprehensive and non-negotiable. We're not compromising on the demands. The students said again and again and again. And even when faculty asked them what are some of the demands are negotiable, they said no. None of them are negotiable, none of them we're putting forward, and we are refusing to be divided to be divided and conquered, and we are refusing to succumb to the way in which the terms of debates are defined. So we are actually reframing things and centering the debate on ourselves as students and our needs, okay? And so this is definitely very much an epistemic insurgency, right? Although it's becoming much more resistance, I guess, because much more organized.
Yeah. Sometimes insurgencies, you start with insurgencies and they blow up into full-on transformative movements, right? Yeah. So, yeah.
I want to just respond to some of the questions on Palestine, and then I wanted to kind of like pick on what Lubna was saying about the shoot the women first and elaborate a little bit. This book, Shoot the Women First, is written by a British journalist. Her name is Eileen MacDonald. And it has several chapters. And each chapter talks about one kind of a woman militant. And what it says, basically, because this woman, Eileen MacDonald, goes and interviews all the security, a lot of security officers in Europe. In the Pentapol, in Germany, in Britain, she interviews people, she talks about people who are in the Irish Republican Army, in the Italian Red Brigade, and so on and so forth. And one of the chapters is about Leila Khalil. And the reason she's actually very intrigued by it is because whenever she talks to all these security agents, they all say that these women who are militants are unnatural women. Mm-hmm. They must be lesbians. They must be having hair growing all over their bodies. I mean, seriously, this is the introduction to the book. And I kid you not, go read it, okay? So it's all, and then one of the security agents says to her, shoot the women first, which is the title. He says that women militants are like the black widow spiders. They are the most dangerous. So you need to shoot the women first because they're more dangerous than men. Which, it's very interesting because it, again, naturalizes femininity and denaturalizes masculinity and says basically women are not supposed to be militants while it's acceptable for men to be militants. Which if you think about and you go post 9/11, 2001, the mainstream discourses in the US, dominant discourses, this is the discussion, is that women, why would women participate? Why are they, men, it's, we understand because it's their men, they're bloodthirsty and they're nasty and they have, as if they have an extra gene that is a violent gene, right? It's like the Y chromosome is supposed to have a violent gene and so on. And the women are supposed to be like nice and nurturing and so on, which is the whole discussion about Leila Khaled, which is the article that Lubna cited, as well as the Catherine Viner, who actually now is the editor of the Guardian. I mean, she is the editor of the Guardian. And the thing is, like, what Matt is talking about is how the article somewhat says. So I want us to also be critical of what how the narrative is. Because both in her film and in her interviews and so on, Leila Khaled says, stop talking about my love life, stop talking about my sex life, stop talking about why did I do, you know, what do I look like and whatever, because this is not what it's about. And she doesn't actually say that it is Palestinian struggle is more important than women's struggle or whatever. What she says, and I actually wrote something about this, it was earlier on in the syllabus, about the ways in which Leila Khaled gets read as in the Viner and elsewhere as a submissive, docile woman that actually doesn't know any better, that she's been duped by the men in the movement, And so the whole, when she says here that when she became really big, because when she was arrested in Britain, and she was, you know, after she and Patricio Arguello from the Sandinista was killed in the kidnapping, and she was arrested and she was put in Ealing police station, the her group, the PFLP, said, we need her to be released. And we're, if she doesn't get released, we're not releasing the passengers on a plane they hijacked. I mean, so she says, I became really big. I thought that I became really big, so I asked to be assigned to be in the refugee camps so I can go live with the people and learn from the people. Okay, think about the education and think about Paulo Freire and the pedagogy of the oppressed. Mm-hmm. Think about what she is saying here is that I need to go and be reminded of what the people are saying. I don't want to become a big, I don't want to have a big ego. The way she gets read is that, oh, she's so submissive, she doesn't think she's really important, she thinks she's just like a little unimportant and, you know, person and so on. But that's actually not the way she sees, you know, herself, and not the way the movement sees her. And the reason that actually she becomes an icon in the Palestinian movement, and anybody here who's taking notes for the AMCHA or, you know, whatever, the Defamation League or whatever, write notes, because I've been accused of, because we had a meeting with her during one delegation, that I am fraternizing with terrorists and so on. And Leila Khaled becomes an icon of feminism and Palestinian feminist women's liberation because she precisely refuses to be defined according to the hegemonic narratives. She is engaging, and those of us who are talking about this are engaging in epistemic insurgency and saying, no, this is the way you define it, but this is not the way we define it. This is not the way we understand. We refuse to say, are you for Palestinian liberation, or are you for women's liberation? Which is the same question, Helen, as Al-Qaws is raising and saying, do not just say you are only for gay liberation or for LGBTQI plus communities, liberation. You are for all of liberation. So they're coming at it from a different perspective, saying that in order for us to talk about the sexual liberation, gender liberation, we really need to talk about all sorts of liberation. We can't talk about one aspect without talking about the other. And if we talk about aspect, not only is it a principled thing to do, not to divide justice, to actually think about the indivisibility of justice, but it also actually doesn't really work for movements if you segment, because you can be divided and you can be, everybody can be compartments, and the movements will lose, which is what the students did when they said our demands are non-negotiable. Okay, so this, there's another book, by the way, which is very interesting in this topic, written by Robin Morgan, who was one of the founders of Ms. Magazine. It's called The Demon Lover. And Rubna, you mentioned about the sexual, you know, violence and so on. And in The Demon Lover, Robin Morgan basically says that any women who participate in militant movements are seduced by the sexual prowess of the male terrorist. So they're not really serious about what they're doing and so on. They are only attracted because the male terrorist figure is so sexy and so full of testosterone and so on, so they're just attracted like flies. I mean, it really does the disservice to women's brains and so on. Read it, I kid you not. I mean, it's actually worse than I'm saying. I'm being very, very, very generous. Okay. I think I just want to add just one more thing about what Tara said about the National Organization of Women and reaching out to white women. I want to, two things. One, I want us to separate between white people and white supremacy. Yeah. Because if we say, because then we end up being too much into identity politics, only talking about people's skin color, then that immediately qualifies them too. So there is two issues. One, about what do we mean about self-determination for communities of color, indigenous communities? That's one big thing. The second issue is, how do we separate between white supremacy and white people? Because it's not white people, it's white supremacy. And there are white people who actually disengage themselves from white supremacy and decide to be part of the struggle and so on. That's not, so I think it's really important, but sometimes it's really hard. But my question is, what if white, young white women who are actually refusing racism of the National Organization of Women refuse to participate? What if you say, I'm not going to privilege business as usual, and I'm not going to help you organize a chapter, and I'm not even going to go look for people of color to participate. You want to do it, you go do it on your own. Yeah, I am not legitimate. Hold on, I'm asking a rhetorical question. How? What if I don't legitimize? Why if I refuse, I say, I'm not participating. I actually refuse to privilege this project and legitimize it by participating, because what you're saying, Lubna, you're talking about the house the house Arabs and the, and you people know what the reference is. This is the reference to Malcolm X speech about the house Negroes and the, you know, like people who are in the field. And so this is the historical kind of like taken from the history of slavery, enslavement and so on, and talking about the people who are actually participate in reproducing and advancing the power structures, but they are actually people from our own communities. So, you know, in the Palestinian movement, we have a lot of those. Don't let me get started. But we also have, in the Muslim community, a lot of people who we say they're engaged in faith washing, mm-hmm. and they go, for instance, to the iftar in the White House every year, and we say you should not be going to that because actually it's very demeaning, and we should not be privileging a policy of an administration that day in and day out is bombing people, is in is surveillance, is engaging in prosecuting, and so on. This is participating in that only ameliorates and gives it authentication, Yesenia, by saying that some of our people are actually there because there is a few, they pick a few people of color and say, see, we have diversity. So then you start talking about, you say, no, no, you are the field Arabs, but then we have the house Arabs who are like really nice and civilized and they look nice and they wear suit and ties and they're so in civility and so on. And we are the bad people because we're crazy and we're like, we're so emotional. And we are so passionate, and it's not used in a good way, it's used in a very negative way. Because it means you're not rational, and you're not thinking about what you're doing. And so you are not so fit to participate in the discussion and the debate, because that's only for normal, rational, logical people. We should not be part of it, right? And like, you know, a lot of you know that you're going into this every day in and day out, in your classes, in the, in campus, with faculty, everywhere, right? We go through this all the time. So this is kind of like why it becomes really, really important to discuss all of these issues and think about what does it mean when these things get constructed and how do we defeat them. So what does it mean then if we refuse to participate? What does it mean if we say we are actually refusing to participate to legitimize these power structures? What does it mean? And sometimes it's very seductive because they try to throw things at us, they try to recruit us, they try to get us to participate in this because sometimes they need, because if we don't participate, they don't have anybody to say we're with you. Like, okay, so and now cannot actually have a chapter if, you know, you and other people say, well, I'm not gonna participate. It's, this is, I'm not asking you personally, I'm just saying hypothetically or, I mean, you know, hypothetically can QS. But what does it mean? How do we deal? You want to respond? Yeah, so, okay. Comments, more questions, more discussions. Yes, Yesenia, yes. See, whoa, I am so lucky you're going to say something. Go ahead.
I had a question again about epistemic exurgency. Is it usually like short term or can it be long term?
Well, it can be both. It can be whatever. It's a baby theory or concept, and so let's just all collectively own it and see what makes sense.
But this is your
yeah, yes, I came like up with it yesterday, yes.
Oh my God, only yes. Yesterday, this is yes. Us. Okay.
Well, I came up with it as I was watching Chicago, right? And I was like, get it, Chicago. And also I was thinking about it in the context of, you know, when in philosophy classes, when you learn about epistemology, one of the first things you learn is P, propositions, right? So S, subject, S knows that P, right? And then there's all this, you know, all the ways that can go awry. But I was thinking about propositions and all the propositions that have been coming up lately, like Black Lives Matter is a insurgent proposition, right? Or undocumented.
And it shouldn't be.
It shouldn't be, but yeah. and yet.
Yeah.
Undocumented and unafraid, right? That's another one.
No.
And so I think that there's these ways that we've been able to, particularly young people, have been able to assert a different framework and then popularize it through organizing and culture work. And I think it's a kind of insurgency, mm-hmm. right? Because it's sort of living in the air. So I think that there's probably ways that it can be long term as well. Do you have anything in mind specifically?
I think, you know, this is whole fight for ethnic studies and expanding it.
That's right.
That is like epistemic.
That's right.
And it's like right now it is, it feels kind of like disorganized and, but it's also disruptive.
That's right.
Of what we're doing here. And it's very inspiring, but also like, I don't know, it's a very critical moment, I feel it.
Right. Yeah.
Where did Issa go? Is she still here? I'm actually kind of interested in like what, I don't know, I know you're saying it's just like a baby and it's like really small, this theory, but like what are the, I don't know, in my head I'm really looking at it as like a decolonial process.
Yeah.
So can you, is it a decolonial process?
I think I can imagine it that way. What do you think? Why do you think that?
I don't know, I mean, just like from the way that you're explaining it, from the questions that are being asked, to the way that you're responding, it sounds like it's like a decolonial tool.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we have many tools, obviously, in the decolonial process.
That's
and so,
right.
like,
That's right.
I think that this is like a really cool thing, one, to kind of present to us as this is, you know, your child,
yeah.
right?
Yeah.
But then I also think that it's really, I think it's really brave to kind of expand beyond the decolonial process, you know, or like the decolonization process, because oftentimes I think that I believe that we're really still stuck in this decolonial process still, you know, and I think that we're going to be in that process for a really long time, but I think it's happening a lot more quickly, and maybe it's because it's the hype that's happening at San Francisco State University that it seems like it's moving a lot quicker than what it is.
Yeah.
But I don't know. And also just from a lot of the things, a lot of the actions that have been happening, particularly in this country, you know, with a lot of state violence, a lot of police brutality, a lot of people that are countering that. There is something that is really being awoken, and I'm kind of curious as to what is it exactly, like what can we name it, and is it, will it ever be named? And it, for me, I just don't see it being named as like a Black Lives Matters movement. I think that definitely BLM is a component and definitely plays a essential and a key component characteristic in it, but what would we call this movement?
No.
Nienda, I think she was like she
responding.
Wanted to respond.
Please,
yeah,
please.
Was,
yes, kind of. I was also just wondering, like, how it just seems as though epistemic insurgency also has like an aura of deconstruction in it.
That's right.
Not just even like beyond colonization, beyond like Western hegemonic rule, just like the deconstruction of all of the concepts and everything that we think that we know, and going beyond to be able to define how exactly and what exactly this entire movement is gonna present, or like how it's gonna manifest in the future.
I mean, I think that thinking about it as a process, or thinking about this larger moment of action and thought as a process and a practice, a praxis, right? A praxis, which means practice and theory together, working together collaboratively, makes a lot of sense, right? And so, what's your name?
Nienda.
So, Nienda, I remember now that you had asked earlier about, I don't remember exactly how you put it, but you were asking, but what are we going to do? Like, how are you going to deconstruct all of this? That's how I heard it.
Specifically, the moral part of the oppression, you know, like how do you spearhead the deconstruction of the obvious oppression that is accepted into the obvious?
Right. How do you make it the obvious? How do you make the fact of the immorality the obvious?
Right.
Yeah.
When it seems already so obvious.
Right, when it seems already so obvious.
To us.
That's deep.
Yeah.
So, no, it's true though. It's like, yeah. It's so true.
But
I was thinking.
Do we have to name it?
No, we don't have to name it. No. But I'm trying to really, So going back to Lubna, I don't think we have to name it today, but I think it will be named over time. I think that as people continue, I think we're in a historic moment, which I think is what you're saying. And as the movements continue to unfold, I think we will figure out ways to describe it. The language will come to us. But I do believe, I agree with you, that we're in a historic moment that has multiple components, multiple social movements, multiple angles and frameworks and theories and things like that. And it's chaotic and brilliant and exciting. But I do like the thing that resonates with me most is when you called it a process and called insurgency, epistemic insurgency, a tool within this broader, this long-term, long trajectory, transformative process, right? That fits to me, right? Getting back to Nienda's point, how do you make the obvious when it's already obvious to some?
Yeah.
To some, right?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I think that's where art comes in. I think art helps a lot. Yeah? Tell me, what's going on?
I mean, within that, I was just thinking, how is it that we combat apathy within that?
Before we go there, let's stay with this one first,
okay.
Then we can talk about it. Well, actually, no.
No, because I feel like it feeds into it, the art. Do we make that, in a sense, combative?
I mean, look, I know this art project was a little bit controversial, but I liked it. And this gets to your point about sexual violence on campus. So there was a young woman who was raped on campus, and she took the mattress.
Yeah, NYU.
That was at NYU, right? So I think it's called Carry That Weight. Isn't that the
Columbia.
Name of the art?
No, Columbia.
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 Yeah. So she took the mattress, and she carried it everywhere she went on campus.
That's very epistemic insurgency.
This is the mattress where he raped me.
Yeah.
And y'all aren't gonna kick him out of school because you're corrupt.
Yeah. Yeah.
But there's no way to talk about it anymore because it's so normalized and there's nothing I can do about it institutionally. So I'm just going to put it in your face every single day and experience the weight of it. And I think, if I'm not mistaken, that other people sometimes helped her carry the mattress, which was really interesting.
It was faculty against rape.
Right, this interesting process where now we all get to carry the weight because it's all of our responsibility, right? Brilliant. So I think that, so that's something that is obvious, but it's hard, but it's not obvious, but you're trying to make it obvious. It has to be through other kinds of channels, you know? So I think art is a really helpful way of doing it.
I wanted to kind of like go back to what Lubna was asking.
Yeah.
And about the whole question about the various movements and so on.
Yeah.
Well, first to kind of like, I think the whole question of decolonial, colonial, anti-colonial, post-colonial, decolonization, all of the terms as we, this is the class about colonialism, imperialism, and resistance. So we continue to have this discussion in the class. And so on. So this is something like an ongoing discussion that some scholars in Latin America or in the party of the indigenous in France, that the children of the immigrants from quote-unquote former colonies to the mother empire, right? There is a lot of discussion about it. Some people like the term, some people have questions about it. But leaving that little bit theoretical footnote aside, I think it's actually really good that there isn't one homogeneous unified movement. I think whenever there is one movement, a lot of voices get silenced. A lot of voices and a lot of concerns get sacrificed. And some people on the margins, and if you want to talk about here, Palestine becomes one of the major issues, is that, why don't you sacrifice for the sake of the movement? Bernie Sanders is a question. One example is that it's one thing, it's kind of like, why aren't people allowed to criticize? We may end up going like this and voting, maybe, but we can actually push him. Roger Waters, just now, of the Wall, called on him, said, I support you, I endorse you. But you need to own up on Palestine. You need to get clear on Palestine. Is that, And so there is a lot of discussions, and this is not the only one. I think a lot of the times we sort of end up sacrificing a lot of struggles because we are trying to kind of like wake men. So I actually like the fact that it's a movement. When you say it's a movement, it has different components and it has different tactics. And not everybody has to do the same thing. And if it has the same thing, actually it can be defeated easily. And there isn't wouldn't be too much space for insurgencies, epistemic or otherwise, all sorts of insurgencies. If you just say everybody has to be conformed to one way of doing things, it becomes actually very problematic. So the ways in which, just like you're organizing in the whole struggle to defend and advance ethnic studies, I mean, some people are trying to say, this is the only group that's behind it. And you're all defying that. You're all saying, no, there is all these different student groups, and there are undergraduates in ethnic studies, and there are graduate students in ethnic studies, and there are students in student groups, and there's so much stuff going on, and there is faculty, and there is community, and there, you know, so it's, I think it's really beautiful, because the minute you start to kind of like discipline it, the minute you start to discipline the movement and draw boundaries around it and define what it is, I think we begin to kind of lose the insurgency edge of it. And then it becomes much more easier to co-opt, to manage, to make it docile, to make it house movement. So then it becomes nothing but another example of diversity, rather than actually the thing that's going to change and make the obvious much more obvious, I think. Go ahead.
I'm not saying that. I think that we should...
I think
one thing is, I don't know, just kind of like when you understand history and you know history and then you're kind of seeing things that haven't really changed over time, mm-hmm. and kind of like, for example, like the civil rights movement has literally been culminated under everything that's around like black liberation, mm-hmm. and has been hijacked to say, okay, this is the civil rights movement, mm-hmm. you know? Mm-hmm. And like, that's a real problem. That's a really big problem for people that are conscious, mm-hmm. for people that have been involved in different movements, for people that came out of those movements, the different organizations that arrived out of that. So I think like, you know, I think there's just like a part of me where it's like, I'm kind of, I don't want to, not that I'm afraid or that I'm scared, I'm not afraid of anything, really. I mean, it takes me a lot to be afraid of something. But like, I think that like what I'm worried about is that 50 years, 60 years down the line, that we look back at stuff at ethnic studies and it's being looked at that it's a part of a movement that has become co-opted,
right.
because of the different ways that we've seen this stuff happen time and time again. You know, and so it's like, for me, I'm kind of constantly thinking about, are we going to be the generation that's going to be like, no, we're not taking this shit anymore? And we're like, no, there's nobody that's going to do this. There's nobody that's going to do that. Everybody's going to be accountable. If you say this, it's going to come back to you. If you don't say this, it's going to come back to you. Like, and I see it. I see it more and more every single day, you know? I just think, I don't know. I just think that our history in this country and also around the world worries me, you know?
Is it history or is it the way history is told?
Well,
I think it's both.
Right. Yeah.
Well, I mean, this is why. Look, part of it is that you're operating within modes of power, and it's not, you know, I understand the worry. I think the worry is real, and we need to be worried about it. But I also think that you have to kind of push as far as you can and do what you can, and like the great thing about a movement is that it's not all on any individual, thank God, and it's way better now than it was, I think. I think there are parts of the civil rights movement that was certainly more collective and grassroots, like Fannie Lou Hamer and everybody, but I think there's also like this kind of memory of a hero, of one singular man hero, forever and ever, right? And I think that now it feels more dispersed. It feels more.
It does.
Yeah. So I think that there are ways to try to capture it. There's radical archiving, right? Mm-hmm. We need to make sure that we're archiving our stuff. We need to make sure that it's there so that when the brothers and sisters that come next, we're like, okay, so what was happening in the 20-teens, you know? And someone says, oh, you know, diversity. And, you know, and then the smart ones will be like, you know, look at this really cool archive I found, right? So we have to archive our things. Archive, and we have brilliant media now. We have more stuff than we used to, just even 10 years ago, right? And so don't keep it all on social. When you're, like, this is just an FYI. It's all, a lot of this amazing stuff is in social networking. We think that those corporations are going to live forever. They're not. They're not, because they're corporations. So go on and figure out ways to don't rely on Twitter. Don't rely on Twitter to archive your stuff. Figure out ways to make backups of all that stuff, right? So that it can be accessible to community folks, activists, artists, and students in the future and in the current time, right? So. Yeah.
And I think this is why, like, what's happening at San Francisco State with ethnic studies is really, really exciting.
Yeah.
Because it's really jolting us in ethnic studies, not to kind of just, like, keep being drunk on what happened historically, and, like, we keep saying, okay, we're the ones who created 68, we're the ones who created this, we're always patting ourselves in the back and say, we're the only college. Actually, we should not be the only college.
No.
It's a problem that we're the only college. Yeah. It's not a good thing to be exceptional. Why isn't this experience reproduced all over the place in different ways? But why isn't that happening? And I think in the College of Ethnic Studies, I think what's going on now, the struggle is going on, is going to make faculty rethink, and students are going to challenge and make faculty rethink the curriculum, how we teach, what are the things that we teach about as nostalgia. Like, things have happened, oh, it was so exciting and wonderful and so on. But it wasn't all exciting, and there were a lot of battles, and there were a lot of ugly things, and this is the nature of the movement, and that's okay, you know, kind of like not to sugarcoat everything, to be there, and so not to tell the story of the civil rights movement as that the way the powers that be say it. Oh, okay, there was civil rights, voting act, and this, what's his name, Johnson did so and so, and Kennedy did so and so, and this is wonderful, this is what happened in history. This is not what happened, people died. People died to make this happen, and there are struggles that have happened, and then, as Alisa is saying, the whole archival question, so there is a lot of things that are actually challenging. How we know what we know, who has legitimacy over knowledge, who's telling the stories, how are the stories being told, and whose story gets left out, and how do we, not just one story, single story. So it's really important to kind of like rethink that, and this is your role as students. I mean, really, it's like if you guys don't continue challenging, stuff is going to be the same, and people are not going to give you new syllabi and not giving you material and so on. You need to demand it. I mean, you really need to demand, you force it on the faculty. That's my last question.
Yeah, last question, I swear to God. I know I'm hella talking, but this is a really exciting conversation. One last thing that I wanted to say is I think that there's something that's like also happening globally around joint struggle movements and solidarity movements, and people taking a really participatory understanding of like anti-Zionism, anti-racism global context that I think is also really important to understanding where ethnic studies is today. Because I'm not sure if there was an anti-Zionism, you know, stance during the 1968 strikes, right? Or was there?
No, there was, but it's left out of the story. Terry Collins will tell you it was.
Right. Yeah. So, I mean, there's just like a lot of narratives that have been coming in that haven't really played a part, and even within the ethnic studies courses or whatever. Like, you know, I find it that we have actually had to find a lot of material outside of within our own classrooms to get this information. Mm-hmm. So, I don't know. It's exciting. It's good shit.
I mean. It is exciting, and it is good shit. You do have to work to get the information. One of the things I was thinking as you were talking was just how fascinated I am that we're still learning things about the Black Panthers.
Yeah.
Right? Still learning things.
Still.
So there was this book that came out a couple years ago. Oh, I feel so bad. I can't think of the name of it. Maybe y'all know. It's about... the biopolitics of the Black Panthers and the ways in which they were doing genetic testing in order to get folks mobilized around, iron deficiency.
Oh, sickle cell anemia.
Sickle cell anemia, right. And so there was this concern that Black people were getting sick and dying from sickle cell anemia, and the government wasn't, because you didn't have access to health care, and the government was like whatever in a genocidal process against black people, that the Black Panthers, we all know about the free breakfast, and we all know about the direct actions, but there's less knowledge around the radical health care projects that they were doing, and the fact that they were doing this radical testing before anyone else, before anyone else, right? And so it wasn't perfect, but it was incredibly creative. And I was shocked when I saw the book. Alondra Nelson is the author. Can't think of the title, but Alondra Nelson is the author.
It's called The Biopolitics of the Black
Panthers. No. It's just about that. It's about that.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, no.
What's the author's
name? Alondra, A-L-O-N-D-R-A.
And what's
it's
name?
On the tip of my tongue.
What's
the title?
Nelson.
It's on the tip of my tongue. Maybe somebody,
but somebody
can Google
finds it, put it on the island so everyone can know about it.
But Alondra, A-L-O-N-D-R-A. Nelson.
But actually, when we did the Black Power mixtapes, it was in the segment that you let it in for the class. There was, I think it was
Body and Soul.
Boom!
Thank you. Yeah. The book is entitled Body and Soul.
Yes.
So Alondra came to Berkeley to do a talk about her book, and I was like, I was pumped. I was so thrilled about all this new information, but I was also kind of irritated because I thought I had it down.
Yeah.
And so I just think it's fascinating that these things continue to be unearthed, but unearthing is an effort. It takes effort.
Right.
Takes commitment.
And this is where you were talking about the Black Solidarity Statement that came out in the summer of 2014.
Yeah.
And I was mentioning the one in 1972.
Yeah.
I think it was 1997 in the New York Times.
Yeah.
And actually there was a professor from San Francisco State College who signed it.
Boom.
And we are now trying to find where that professor is and dig out the history of it. I think Carrie had her hand up, and I know Matt has his hand up a while ago, and Tara had her hand up. So I'm going to go with Tara.
Oh.
You're okay?
Yeah.
Or you have a question?
Well,
okay.
Can we,
Matt,
can we
and then
we
go to Carrie.
I'm okay.
Can we call
okay.
this woman in
yeah.
the glasses?
Carrie, yeah.
Hi.
Yeah.
I have a quick question, I guess more for clarification, on this idea of using House Negroes to refer to like Palestinian struggle, because I personally think that's a little problematic, but I just kind of want to understand where that comes from.
Oh.
Just so that I understand the context before I like go into my analysis, because that might be like...
Yeah, when Lubna was talking about, she was saying that there are House Arabs, she was saying the way in which Leila Khalid gets constructed. And then she went into something, another idea that I think like I connect the dots because I know what she's talking about, but it's not necessarily like available, you know, like immediately. The dots don't get connected everywhere. But we, like, this is the question of the internalized colonialism, basically. So when you say House Arabs or House Palestinians, you're talking about people who are internally colonized, who actually reproduce the narrative of the colonizers about the colonized. So when you say in the Palestinian context, as in every other context, it's not exceptional, it's not only in the Palestinian context, in every single context, even we can talk about it in the context of what we're going to be struggling in San Francisco State now, right? Because we do have some people, some of the deans, by the way, who signed the statement, they're not all white people, they're people of color who signed it.
Okay.
So, all right, so then there is this house, the people who are in the house, who get the privilege, who they get some privileged life compared to the people in the field, compared. It's not actually absolute. They never ever have the same power as those in power. They do not. But they are given some crumbs in order to seduce them to participate in the project of reproducing power hierarchies, and thus are, because like when in Malcolm's speech, he actually talks about this like a lot, you know, and I don't remember, I don't know if it was the ballot and the bullet or another one, but he actually speaks about that, and he says some people are basically justifying the system and making it business as usual,
right,
when it should not be business as usual, because they may be getting some rewards out of it. Okay, so in the Palestinian context, I can tell you this, the people who are continuously justifying Oslo, for instance, or the people maybe on campus here who think that they were going to come and actually participate in saying that the Israeli occupation is really wonderful. We could call them the House Palestinians because they are in the house of the colonizers, because it is not our house. This is not the home and the homeland Lumna is talking about. This is the house of the colonizer. This is the house of the dominant, powerful groups that are actually giving a little bit of crumbs and maybe getting somebody to come become the, you know, the cleaner of the house or so on, and they're very happy, you know. Just very little anecdote. When the Algerian Revolution won in 1962, they banned shoe shining. They banned shoe shining because they did not think any person should be sitting and cleaning the shoes of another, because it was very demeaning. As, so this is kind of like, okay, so if you are a shoe shiner for the colonizer, if you're cleaning the boots of the soldiers of the colonists, what are you doing? Okay, so you maybe are giving a little bit of space, maybe you get a little bit of permit to cross borders and so on, you get some privileges, and you think that you are actually part of this power structure, but you never become. This is what would, you know, kind of like, I'm going to leave the last thing to you. Mm-hmm. Okay, so now follow up. So it's clear, so yeah.
Okay, so I guess my question would then be like, how would that make sense contemporarily when we're trying to talk about transnational solidarity and like recognizing anti-blackness within non-black communities? And like how using that can be a form of anti-blackness, because it's using that in the theoretical sense as opposed to something that actually happened to create divides within those communities that are like based in really intensive violence that happens within those two. So I guess for me, like moving away from the theoretical and more into like real lived experiences of people and that historical trauma and not like co-opting that, like how can we become better allies in transnational struggles while also recognizing anti-blackness in the discussion of settler colonialism? Because the way that we see colonizers within other countries are seen as like white or white passing, mm-hmm. and can have like a white mentality in perpetuating white supremacy. But anti-blackness is at the root, like that has no space for citizenship, while people who are not black can have accessibility to that citizenship. Does that make sense? Obviously, it changes within the context of Palestine because it's like a different am I making sense?
Right. I'm going to say a couple of things, but then I'm going to, you know, like have Alisa have the last word.
Yes, of course.
Yeah, I mean, we're here. We can speak all the time. So I just want to like just make sure that I'm not misunderstood, that when we're talking about the question of house Negroes and field Negroes, we're talking about specific historical reference to Malcolm X. I'm not in favor of reproducing these terminologies. And I'm one person who never uses the N-word. And I refuse, and I think when young people use it, I think it's wrong. That's my opinion. I mean, you got, but I...
Right.
I think it's wrong on all levels. But that's me. Maybe I'm older generation, whatever, whatever. But so I agree, and I don't think the Palestinian context is exceptional or different. And I think but I do think that race works differently in different contexts. Okay, race is always employed and it always utilized in order to differentiate and discriminate people. And when I say discriminate, I'm not talking about just superficial, I'm talking about like real access to what if you want to take citizenship or any kind of things. But it does work differently in different places. So I think when we want to talk about what do we understand by anti-blackness, and let's say in the Palestinian context, okay, how do we talk? And this is a bigger discussion. I'm not going to open it now, but we can talk about it. Like actually, we're going to have plenty of opportunities down the semester to talk about that. But how do we talk about, for instance, in Israel? And now I'm not talking Palestine, I'm talking about Israel. There's two different contexts, even though one is on top of the other, okay? How do we understand what is going on with Ethiopian Jews and the rapid discrimination and the horrible, I mean, like brutalization that is going on? And I am always cautioning against the short, shortcut of kind of always bringing in African Palestinians and Ethiopian Jews and everybody together and just lumping everybody together, and they say, this is anti-blackness. Mm-hmm. I want to resist that tendency to do shortcuts, because I think the issue is much more worthy and necessary to understand and analyze and come up with really sophisticated analysis than the shortcut in order for us to have quick solidarity overnight. because the solidarity has built along over a very long period of time. And when you say African, actually, when you say African, African diaspora or African American, there is multi layers of it. It involves so many layers of so many people in so many places, including part of the Arabs are in Africa. Okay, so when we say Middle East and North Africa, it actually kind of like separates that. Or so it actually have another colonial purpose of it. So I think we need to think about all of, there's a lot of stuff that we need to talk about. But so I don't want to kind of, I don't want to cut corners. I'm just mentioning some of the headings that I think we need to think about and we need to discuss. And I'm one person who don't want to like collapse things and say this is the same, or you know, right on the bus, Palestinians can get on the settler bus and then they call it, okay, freedom rights. I'm like, no, please, this is really problematic. I love the fact that young people are active, but this is very problematic. You're collapsing history, you're erasing a whole bunch of, a whole lot of other stuff that's going on. Don't do it this way just because you think you can get, and they did get, the Palestinians got the Southern Christian Leadership Conference, right? SCLC. Yeah. They got a whole bunch of people from Martin Luther King Center and so on to sign on and say, oh, this is wonderful. I'm like, why are you doing this? Okay, but that's another big discussion, which I think in the politics of solidarity, we really need to have a lot of discussion.
I don't think I have anything to add.
Yes.
I mean, just for folks who don't know what Malcolm was talking about, right? That was in the context of slavery, where he was describing a particular kind of dynamic of power within the context of being enslaved, right? And you were saying the colonizer within. So this way of I don't know, drinking the Kool-Aid, as they say, right? For house Negroes and for field Negroes. I think that that Malcolm's formulation is interesting. Mm-hmm. I think it's sort of with a sense of humor, but I also think it's really serious and complicated and open to critique. But you know, obviously Malcolm. Great. I also think that language and analogy is fundamentally messy, because what happens is, you know, things get put out there, and especially, you know, I completely agree with Rabab. Race works differently in different places. It also works differently in different times. Mm-hmm. And then language kind of lives throughout history, and it's hard to track where the concepts are coming from. Like, who knows? I mean, I bet maybe y'all know, but intersectionality has become so well known now. No. Who knows who coined the term? Okay.
What?
How many people knew that before she said that out loud? A couple people. Okay, a few people. So that's great. Excellent. Good job. But most people don't know, right? I was at a conference a couple, I don't know, last year. And people were using intersectionality all the time, just all the time. I did a workshop and participants were using it. And then when I did the talk of the, you know, to the 1,000 people, and I asked for people to raise their hands, they didn't know. Mm-hmm. And that's okay, like there's no judgment. I mean, you know, whatever. But I just think that it's a reflection of the ways in which language moves sometimes rootlessly. Mm-hmm. And sometimes that has to do with power, right? Mm-hmm. So then, given that the way in which it deals with power, the ways in which the people, the collectives and the movements and the individuals who are creating that language sometimes get sort of marginalized or hidden, you know, that kind of thing, then the, you know, I think Rabab is right. I think that the next thing is to try to figure out what the ethical practice is, right? So what is an ethical practice as revolutionaries who are in solidarity with multiple kinds of movements in multiple times, in multiple places, in multiple contexts, knowing that it's going to get messy, inevitably, what does the ethical practice look like, right? And sometimes the ethical practice is, you know, wait, what? Where did this come from? Mm-hmm. Can somebody explain this to me? Yeah. You know, so, yeah, I don't think, that's all
I just, you know, the, I do want to say one thing.
This is a project for CRG.
Yeah, no, God. So, the, so, but I do want to end on one thing because I do have a little bit of a.
No, no, I'm not talking about this particular. I'm talking this whole discussion.
No, I know, I know.
Thank you.
Well, no, I have a pet. It's more like a soapboxy thing. As co-revolutionaries, which I'm just gonna read y'all as. I'm going to urge y'all, I mean, one of the things that I think is happening in the work, sometimes, so there's so much love going on in these movements, and I'm so thrilled, and sometimes there's like, and this isn't actually anything about anybody, what anybody has said here, this is just something that's been on my mind, a lot of hardness and a lot of ugliness sometimes comes up, and then when it gets sort of caught up on Twitter and Facebook and that kind of thing, a lot of damage is caused. And then I think what happens is we go into this route where we start doing brilliant analysis about gender and race and sexuality and nation, colonization, blah, blah, blah. And that analysis is really important. I'm not saying we shouldn't do it. But what I am saying is also, in addition to that, I would just be like, just act right. You know what I mean? Like, if that has been one of the most powerful ethical kind of pushes that I've had over the course of my life. And the thing is that when I'm about to do something fucked up, a voice comes up in my head and be like, what would your mom say if she saw you pulling that crap, right? And then I just, you know? And so it might be politically problematic and complicated and zaza, and again, all that's important, but sometimes I think people get lost in it, and I just want you to take and when you're thinking about what an ethical practice is as revolutionaries, just what does it look like to be decent? What does it look like to just act right? What does it look like to just
get your shit together,
mm-hmm. right? Take care of business and that kind of thing. Just be, you know, just what your mom said. So.
Okay. So, on your behalf and mine, I want to thank Alisa, soon to be Dr. Bierria, for joining us for this really interesting and amazing conversation. A few announcements. Please do the evaluation forms. We want to know if you like it. Aside from the students in the class, do you find this interesting? And so on, please do that. Two, you know, for the students in the class, March 30th is when you are supposed to go and do your research. There is no class, so that's when you're doing your research, and that's when the deadline is. I'm just reminding you. April 6th is we're doing the class on Palestine and Puerto Rico with Jaime Bebe and others. April 13th, we are going to the Freedom Archives because there is a strike. We are not, so we're going to be there at 3 p.m. Please look at the iLearn. You guys are always missing where the class is, and I'm not pointing at anybody in particular, but it is on iLearn. I already posted it. I already sent you a message, and I put it on the news. Okay, we're going to be at Freedom Archives, and we're going to talk about the archives. They're actually going to give us a whole presentation about what they have, what they're doing, and so on, which will be very helpful in your projects. April 20th, we're doing the event on the prisoners, and May 4th is going to be on labor, and May 11th is going to be the last class where you will all present your amazing, great projects. Okay, so I want to thank you again.
Wait, hold on, sorry. When are we going to the Freedom Archives?
April 13th is on Ireland.
Oh, okay.
I already posted it.
Okay.
Everything is on Ireland. Just read the website, okay? All right, thank you. I'm going to hold office hours now while AMED minors and people who are going to interested in AMED minor can meet. And I want to thank you all again.